Looking for magic cards? At flipsidegaming.com you can now use the promo code LVD to get a 10% discount on orders over $10 while supporting the channel at the same time. Hello and welcome to another Magic Arena gameplay video. Today we are revisiting the Grixis Dragons archetype updated with War of the Spark. It's been a while since we've last covered this archetype. We used to play the full 4 copies of Sarkhan Fireblood at 3 mana and then try and ramp into some expensive 5 and 6 mana dragons like Niv-Mizzet. But now we've replaced Sarkhan Fireblood with some other cards, since we're no longer interested in ramping into expensive dragons, since the top end has been replaced with Sarkhan the Masterless making a dragon token, and Nicol Bolas Dragon God as well, so we wouldn't be taking full advantage of Sarkhan Fireblood's abilities. We also shifted the mana base around a little bit, where we used to be a blue-red deck splashing a bit of black, now we're a black-red deck splashing a little bit of blue for the two copies of Nicol Bolas. And then we still have some of our staples, like Dragon's Horde drawing us additional cards whenever a dragon enters a battlefield under our control, and still plays quite well with Sarkhan Masterless making a dragon token. And then we also have one copy of Spitflame as a pretty thematic removal spell in our deck. So let's take a look at our entire decklist. At 1 mana we've got 3 copies of Shock as a cheap removal spell, giving us a bit of early interaction. Also plays well with Dragon's Horde, since we can play Dragon's Horde and still play Shock for 1 mana afterwards. Then at 2 mana we've got some Planeswalker removal and creature removal in the form of Angrath's Rampage. Can also hit artifacts every now and then, even though there's not a ton of artifacts in Standard right now. But also being able to kill hexproof creatures like Paradise Druid on turn 2 is quite useful. And then we also have 2 copies of Bedak Bedazzle, mostly using this to kill opposing creatures. Every now and then you could also use this as a pump spell, pumping our 4-4 dragon up to a 7-1, dealing 3 additional damage to maybe close out the game, and Bedazzle can also be useful at helping us destroy flipped Oskantas. And then we also have the full 4 copies of Treasure Map, which I quite like in this deck, especially combined with Dragon's Horde, since on turn 2 we can play our Treasure Map, on turn 3 play Dragon's Horde, and then with the 1 mana from Dragon's Horde, we can still scry with our Treasure Map so we can transform it as soon as possible, and then once we transform the Treasure Map we get access to some treasure tokens which we can sacrifice to make mana or sacrifice to the transformed Treasure Cove to draw additional cards. And then at 3 mana we've got our 4 copies of Dragon Sword, which is one of our card draw engines, besides Treasure Map as well, and plays quite nicely alongside some of the dragons we'll get to in a second, and also just helps us ramp and fix our mana, which is useful. Then we've got 2 copies of Bedevil as another versatile removal spell dealing with artifacts, creatures and planeswalkers at instant speed. We've got our 1 Spitflame as a nice recursive removal spell, and then 2 copies of Cryvita Carnarium, which can deal with go wide decks, giving everything -2/-2 and also exiling all creatures that end up in the graveyard this turn. I do prefer Ritual of Soot as a sweeper right now, but mostly because of our curve, we would like a 3 mana sweeper instead of a 4 mana sweeper, since we have so many other things to do at 4 mana. And one of those of course is Nicol Bolas the Ravager, which is one of the main reasons to play Grixis in Standard. 4 mana for a 4-4 flying dragon, and when Nicol Bolas the Ravager enters the battlefield, each opponent has to discard a card, so it gets us a little bit of value right away. And then for 7 mana we can also transform Nicol Bolas into Nicol Bolas the Arisen, which is a very powerful planeswalker that can draw us additional cards, deal 10 damage to a creature or planeswalker, or return a creature or planeswalker from the graveyard to the battlefield under our control. So just a ton of value for just 4 mana, and it's also a dragon that triggers our Dragon's Horde. And then we also have 2 copies of Varric's Bladewing, which every now and then we'll play for 4 mana, but we would prefer to save it for 7 mana when we can play it with Kicker, because then not only do we get a 4-4 flying dragon, but we also get a 4-4 flying dragon token, and both of those dragons will trigger the Dragon Sword, so we get to put 2 counters on the Dragon Sword to then draw additional cards with, and also just provides a ton of board presence, so we can pressure opposing planeswalkers or maybe protect our own. And then we also have 2 copies of Vraska's Contempt as another versatile removal spell that can exile a creature or planeswalker, and also gains us 2 life. And then we get to our heavy hitters at 5 mana. We've got 3 copies of Sarkhan the Masterless, which can come into play, -3 right away, making a 4-4 dragon creature token with flying. And then the static ability is also quite relevant in this deck, because whenever a creature attacks us or a planeswalker we control, each dragon we control deals 1 damage to that creature, which means if we have something like a Varric's Bladewing or a Nicol Bolas protecting our planeswalkers, even if they deal with a dragon token, we still have an additional dragon in play protecting our life total from any 1 toughness creatures. And of course, the more dragons we have, the more creatures from the opponent we can stop attacking us. And then the plus one ability also turns all our planeswalkers into 4/4 dragons that can also help us pressure opposing planeswalkers and close out the game pretty quickly. And the other planeswalker in our deck, besides transforming Nicol Bolas the Ravager, is Nicol Bolas Dragon God, 5 mana for a 4 loyalty planeswalker. The static ability on Nicol Bolas is quite interesting, giving him all the loyalty abilities of all other planeswalkers on the battlefield, so we can maybe just copy our own ability from Sarkhan, making a 4/4 dragon token instead of having to use the -3 to destroy a creature or planeswalker, and every now and then the opponent's gonna have a planeswalker in play that has a neat ability we would like to use. Then the plus one ability lets us draw a card, and then each opponent has to exile a card from their hand or a permanent they control, so either way we get some additional value. And then the -3 of course can destroy a creature or planeswalker, and the -8 ultimate can also be game winning. And then the mana base, we've got 26 lands total since we don't really want to miss any land drops, and we can always scry additional lands to the bottom with treasure map if we're flooding out. And then we've got plenty of basic lands, making our mana base a lot less painful than some of the other 3-color decks. So we've got 3 swamps, 3 mountains, then all the red-black dual lands, since we're a red-black deck at its core, with 4 Dragonskull Summit, 4 Blood Crypt, and then some other dual lands as well, 2 Sulphur Falls, 2 Steam Vents, and then also the full 4 copies of Watery Grave, and the full 4 copies of Drowned Catacomb, since we do need more black mana early than red mana, since we need to cast a Cry of the Carnarium for double black, Bedevil for double black, and Contempt for double black as well, whereas the double red on Varix and Sarkhan don't come up as early, since often we're kicking Bladewing instead of playing it for 4 mana anyway. So that's our deck, now let's jump into some games and see how the deck does. Alright, we're on the play, and we've got a Keeper, we've got our turn 2 treasure map into turn 3 Dragon Sword plus Scry, some removal. And that should buy us some time until we can find some of our own threats. Facing tapped Hallowed Fountain. Alright, let's play our summits into Dragon Sword, hope it resolves. Would also help us ramp into a Sarkhan next turn if we wanted to. I'll make sure to put a stop on the opponent's end step here, so we can scry with map. And then we'll decide next turn whether or not we want to scry an upkeep, or maybe try and resolve Sarkhan already. Alright, up against the Jeskai. And they're gonna bounce the Dragon's Horde. Alright, so we're gonna scry a response, find another horde. Don't think we need that. So now I might as well scry on upkeep. Like, we could draw into Nicol Bolas the Ravager. I guess it's maybe worth it to just take our draw step on the off chance that we did draw Nicol Bolas. And then we'll just replay Dragon Sword and be able to scry with our map. I probably would have bottomed this Bedak Bedazzle, although it could still come in handy for opponent plays in Ascanta at some point. It's gonna be Shalai instead. Fair enough. Hits us for 1. And then we'll scry end of turn. Don't need more hordes. And then probably just flipping the map on upkeep here. Ooh, Nicol Bolas Dragon God, that's pretty appealing. Kinda wish we had used Bedak on the zombie token now. Yeah, I mean, we'll definitely keep this. I might just play Sarkhan first. So if we play Sarkhan, we can make a dragon token, and that's also going to put a counter on the Dragon's Horde. And then maybe next turn we get to play Nicol Bolas. If our opponent has removal for the dragon token, they get to kill Sarkhan. So we could also decide to deal with Shalai first. But I think I like getting on the board. If our opponent didn't have that zombie token, then playing Nicol Bolas and minusing would have been pretty tempting. So we'll see what happens. Hopefully our dragon survives. Alright, it's gonna be a second Callous Dismissal. It's pretty effective here. Opponent gets to take out Sarkon and hit us for 3. Alright, let's untap. And now we can just play Nicol Bolas and then still have Bedak Bedazzle to deal with the zombie to protect our Nicol Bolas. That seems worth it. We will have to sack some treasures in order to make this play, since we can't use the treasure cove for mana. But I think that's acceptable. So and I'll do this now to protect our Dragon God. And then we can still draw with our Treasure Cove end of turn. Ooh, Immortal Sun. Well, good thing we've got a Bedevil to deal with it. Grixis does have quite a few answers for artifacts, unlike some of the other color combinations. So we can draw with our Cove. And then I'll Bedevil, and then we can still play our Ravager as well. I will return. Opponent exiles a land, play Nicol Bolas, and then end of turn we can draw with a Dragon's Hoard. Discards a Spark Double. Alright, so we're in a pretty good spot. It's gonna be another Shalai which we can contempt. Ferrix Bladewing is also gonna be quite good here with our Dragon Sword in play. So I guess we'll start by plussing. We could also transform Nicol Bolas the Ravager. Might actually be better than using Contempt here. Can attack first either way. So yeah, how about we transform Nicol Bolas here into a Planeswalker as well. If our opponent has another Immortal Sun, that could be kind of bad. But I think this is fine. And now, could also just get back Sarkon. It's pretty tempting too. Although then we're not dealing with Shalai. I guess we'll just kill Shalai here. -3. Now Nicol Bolas Dragon Card can also use the Arisen's abilities, so we can draw 2 cards instead of just 1 if we want to. And yeah, this game is over. Alright, on to the next one. Alright, we're on the play with a pretty solid hand. Can cast either a turn 3 Bedevil or Dragon Sword into Nicol Bolas. And a pretty painless mana base. Opponent on Sulphur Falls, could be Jeskai, could be Izzet Phoenix. Izzet Phoenix confirmed. Curving Dragon Sword into Nicol Bolas is tempting, although Electromancer is a pretty threatening card, so I'm probably just gonna Bedevil that. And then we'll see whether we want to play the Horde before Nicol Bolas or if we can wait. It's gonna be Discovery. Nothing goes in the graveyard, so our opponent was happy with our top card. And they seem to have a shock in hand as well here, which is good to know. Alright, Bedak. So now I think I like playing Horde. Keep up Bedak. So if our opponent does have another Electromancer, we still get to kill it. And then we get a bit of value out of our Horde when we do play Nicol Bolas. Playing Nicol Bolas against the Phoenix deck can also be a downside if they're holding Arclight Phoenix, since sometimes they'll happily discard it. It's gonna be Crackling Drake instead. Kind of the reverse Nicol Bolas. Doesn't die to Bedak, sadly. Alright, so let's start by playing Nicol Bolas. Discards Arclight Phoenix. And I think I will play the treasure map instead of drawing with a horde. Put a stop on upkeep so we remember to scry before drawing. Although we could also just attempt to transform Nicol Bolas if he survives. That's also a play we can make. Alright, there's the Electromancer. Do we see a Lava Coil? Or maybe Double Shock? It's gonna be a 1-mana Chard, of course. So we'll see whether they can get back Arclight Phoenix. So they've cast one instant or sorcery so far. Tormenting Voice is the second one. Do they have a land plus another 1-mana spell? It's Islands. We suspect they have a Shock in hand, but apparently they didn't have a Mountain or an Opt. So that worked out well for us. Now if we do transform Nicol Bolas and, for example, kill the Crackling Drake, then the Electromancer could threaten to finish off Nicol Bolas, especially if they also have a Shock. So I don't necessarily love flipping Nicol Bolas right now, so I think we will scry with the map. And Spitflame seems like a pretty good one here. Keep that on top, draw. And then we can Spitflame the Drake and bedeck the Electromancer. Make it difficult for the opponent to cast three spells in the same turn. And get an attack for four. And next turn we'll happily flip Bolas if the coast is clear. All their opponent does have double Phoenix in the graveyard, so that's always pretty scary, especially with the printing of Finale of Promise, which can cast three spells for just one card. It's gonna be an Augur Bolas, so probably won't see three spells this turn. And there's Opt that our opponent needed last turn. So we know if they have an Opt, we suspect a Shock, so it's gonna be Lightning Strike Shock here. So they're gonna kind of give up on getting Phoenix back this turn, but they just want to deal with Nicol Bolas before we can flip him, which makes sense. Make sure to put a stop on upkeep again. Draw with Horde. Rampage, and then we'll scry before drawing. And just looking for more action. Or 5-mana Planeswalkers, any dragons. Cry doesn't quite cut it. Although Cry of the Carnarium is a great answer to Arclight Phoenix. So I'm just gonna pass a turn for now. There's always a chance our opponent plays Saheeli, and we can use Rampage to make them sacrifice a Planeswalker. Augur of Bolas isn't really doing much. Alright, there's Finale of Promise, getting back Lightning Strike and Chard, of course. Uh-oh, did our opponent misclick? That's awkward. Well, we would have had the Crowd of Carnarium for double Arclight Phoenix, we would have taken 7 down to 13. And our opponent would have cast a Lightning Strike, putting us to 10, plus Chard, of course. Now they didn't get to do any of that. So I'm a little bit sad that the mistake happened there, since now the game might be a little bit less interesting. Alright, well, let's play our Sarkon. Make a dragon, put a counter on the Horde. And I guess get back our Spitflame. So if they did get back Phoenix, we wouldn't have been able to make this play, since we probably would have had to play our Cry. So the game would have been a little bit different. But we'll see. Opponent, of course, still has a good chance. Shock can take out Sarkon. And they're just gonna hardcast Arclight Phoenix. Attack Sarkon. Augur of Bolas also gets in there. Come on, listen to them roar. Think I'm just gonna block the Phoenix here. You are bold. Opponent already played a land for the turn, so we didn't need to fear a second main Shock. Let's turn Sarkon into a dragon. Are you ready? Get in there. Could see keeping the token back, but this is a two-turn clock, although of course Shock is basically guaranteed to kill Sarkon. So keeping the dragon back could be worth it here. We've got plenty of card draw engines going, so I'm not in a hurry to close out the game, because we have the Cry to deal with triple Phoenix. So think I'll start by drawing with the Horde itself. Another cry. Let's draw with the Cove. And then we'll play another Horde. Play the Stabs, say go. And we'll see what happens. Ooh, Niv-Mizzet's. That's a good one. That could be an issue. Could always spit flame plus cry. But our opponent's gonna get quite a bit of value in the meantime. I have lost. Nicol Bolas can get their last card. Can we Spitflame, Niv-Mizzet, play Nicol Bolas, get back Spitflame and cast Spitflame? I think we can. So let's go for it. Opponent will get to draw two cards. And they will get to decide between two cards what to discard instead of having to discard the one card they had in hand. But this way we get to save Cry for Phoenix. And we also get value out of our Spitflame, which is nice. And attack for four. Alright, so we're not doing too bad. Opponent does have three cards in hand. Still gotta be careful with triple Phoenix in the graveyard. Crackling Drake is also a pretty big threat. So yeah, these Augur of Bolas, while looking pretty innocuous, are actually shutting down our Angrass Rampage pretty effectively. Our opponent did have an unfortunate misclick with the Finale of Promise, although we did have Arclight Phoenix covered with Cry of the Carnarium. Alright, we're on the play with, I guess, a reasonable hand. We can cast our Bedevil and our Spitflame, and then we gotta hope to draw some lands to cast Sarkon. And if we find a treasure map or a dragon sword in the meantime, this would be useful too. I'll play the Steam Vents tapped instead of a Watery Grave in case we draw a shock. That way we can shock on turn two and still play a tapped Watery Grave alongside it. We did find our second red source, so that's good. It's gonna be a Goblin Crater Maker turn 2. I wonder if this is a Goblin Tribal deck, perhaps. I think I'm gonna keep up our removal spells and just take 2 in case our opponent has a Legion War Boss that we wanna kill instead. And then of course we can play our tap lands next turn and play the other removal spell. So I'll put a stop here just in case our opponent plays a War Boss. They did not play War Boss. Do we still wanna take 2? I guess at this point I'm okay Spitflaming. Bedevil's a bit more versatile. If they play a Krenko, we've got an answer. And it is indeed going to be a Krenko. And since we did pick up a Contempt, we're happy using Bedevil here. I'll pass a turn, and then just Bedevil Krenko before he gets a chance to attack. And then we're just one land away from playing 3 Sarkons in a row. Alright, it's going to be a backup Krenko. So we could Contempt Krenko, or we can play Sarkon. So what's the worst that can happen if we play Sarkon? Opponent kills our dragon token, kills Sarkon, now has a pretty big Krenko, some goblin tokens, but the goblin tokens themselves won't be able to pressure us if we play our second Sarkon because of the static ability. So I think I will take a turn off here playing Sarkon. Don't have the red mana to get back Spitflame, but maybe next turn, if we draw land, we can. Alright, Lava Coil, pretty good answer to our dragon. So first Sarkon down. Opponent gets ahead thanks to Krenko. And it's gonna be a treasure map to draw. I think I'm gonna just run it back. And hope we don't end up dying to another lava coil. They could of course also just shock or lightning strike or Sarkon to get rid of the static, but we still have a third one lined up. I will be a bit more protective of the third copy than I was the first two. Looks like they have to double lightning strike the dragon. Alright. There's our land, so now we could play Sarkon, make a dragon, get back Spitflame, but then Krenko is going to be attacking as a 4-5, so it can attack past our dragon token. So now I will Contempt Krenko, and we want to take 2 to play a treasure map. Our life total could matter, so I don't think I do. Just pass the turn. I guess your opponent could have that instant sacrificing a creature dealing 4 damage, so it could be worth it to main phase a Contempt here, probably not a ton of downside. If our opponent plays a Goblin Trashmaster here, we're in a bit of trouble. It's gonna be a Legion War boss instead. Alright, this last Sarkon really needs to stick around. Otherwise we're gonna be in trouble, so we get to play Sarkon, pay the red mana to get back Spitflame. Alright, no removal on Sarkon yet. Alright, looks like we did it. Sarkon stabilizes our board. Of course, our opponent still has all those goblins in place, so once they do find an answer for Sarkon, we could still be in a bit of trouble. But at least for now, we're relatively safe. So, we'll plus. I summon you. Could also attack with our dragon itself. We do want to start pressuring our opponents. Our hand doesn't have any additional threats. And we're gonna Spitflame War Boss anyway. So I think we're fine attacking. And then we can play Treasure Map, Scry. And yeah, we'll keep Nicol Bolas the Ravager, which can also buy back Spitflame here. And then we'll put a stop here with a plan of Spitflaming the Legion War Boss. And then hope they don't answer Sarkon anytime soon. And now we've got a backup dragon to help us with a static ability as well. So let's plus attack for another 8 points. I suppose we could also make the argument that we should only be attacking with 1/4/4 since next turn we'll have plenty of dragons to close out the game anyway. Is that one extra blocker gonna make a difference? Let's say our opponent plays a Goblin Trashmaster. We can, I guess, still kill it with a Spitflame. 4, 5. Yeah, we have just enough mana to get back Spitflame and cast it. So I think we are probably fine attacking with both. Make sure we end the game. So we've got to be a little bit careful how we tap our mana. Don't want to tap any unnecessary red. Not killing Krenko, of course, was a little bit risky. Opponent had 2 answers for 2 of our Sarkons, but once the third copy stuck around, we were in the clear. Alright, on to the next one. Alright, we're on the draw, and our hand is a little bit on the slow side, especially given that we're on the draw already. So there's definitely matchups where we would mulligan this hand, but I think I'm still gonna try. And then hope we are not facing a hyper aggro deck. And if we are, that we draw some early ramp or cheap interaction. Opponent on Esper. And a Thought Erasure on turn 2. Well, at least our hand is pretty good against the Thought Erasure since we've got a ton of powerful threats. Takes Nicol Bolas, which was our only proactive turn 4 play. So if they have a Thief of Sanity, they could get in an attack. It's going to be a search for Ascanta instead, and there's Bedazzle, which can deal with a flipped Ascanta. Although that's going to take a while. Just going to play the Stabs. Our life total could end up mattering. So even though our opponent didn't know about the Steam Vents, I don't think it's worth it to bluff. Alright, Bell Haunts. Now we could still discard Bedak Bedazzle. A flipped Ascanta is pretty difficult to beat for us. So maybe the play is just discarding Contempt and keep Bedazzle. Both our 5 mana threats are pretty good. Although they do get a little bit worse if our opponent gets to keep the Bell Haunt in play. Maybe we just discard a land and hope to draw a fifth one. Yeah, I mean, we do get two more draw steps here. Alright, good. So we get to Contempt the Bell Haunt right now. I guess we might want to main phase it, although if they have a Dovin's Veto, they could counter our Planeswalkers anyway. So I think I'll wait. I guess there is a downside to waiting. If our opponent has a Tyrant Scorn, they could bounce their own Bell Haunt back to their hand. But then they wouldn't be able to replay it, and we will be able to resolve a 5 mana Planeswalker with no pressure in play. So it's not all that bad. Alright, Thought Erasure number 2. What are they taking this time? Probably Nicol Bolas. Yup. So we get to play our Sarkhan, make a dragon. And Varix could be good if we hit some more land drops. No sword can pierce my scale. In the meantime, our opponent has 3 cards in the graveyard for Ascanta. So it's still gonna take a while before it transforms. And Contempt takes care of Sarkhan. Alright, let's get in there. We could play 4-4 Bladewing. I think I'm gonna wait. The downside of waiting, if our opponent has another Thought Erasure, they could take it away. But then they're not taking away our answer to Ascanta. Alright, can't use Rampage. I think I'm gonna be patient here. 5 cards in graveyard, so not too far from a flipped Ascanta, which we have to deal with, otherwise I don't see us winning the late game. Alright, let's play a map. And we can scry towards a 7th land or towards some more action. End of turn, put a stop on upkeep just in case. So still only 5 cards in graveyard. Ooh, Immortal Sun. Luckily we have Angrass Rampage to make them sacrifice an artifact, so that's fine. And do we want another treasure map? Sure, why not? So no need to scry an upkeep. And then we just get to Rampage, sacking an artifact. Play another map, and then we can scry twice. And then probably deal with a flipped Ascanta here. Opponent didn't seem to have a counterspell a turn ago, so hopefully they won't be able to answer Bedazzle. Although they do get to activate Ascanta, but they only have a single blue source, so if they find a counterspell, they won't be able to play it. So end of turn, we'll scry some more. And do we want to land? I think I'm bottoming this, since we're gonna cast Bedazzle this turn cycle anyway, so I'm not gonna play the Kick Bladewing yet. I would rather just have more action to follow up with. And we could flip the map. I guess that's probably worth it. And we want to keep a land on top now. If we keep land on top, we don't have to sack a treasure. But I think I'm gonna still look for more action here. In case they Thought Erasure Varix, we want some good follow-ups. Sarkhan's a great follow-up. I guess end of turn we Bedazzle Ascanta. If our opponent does have a counter spell in hand, maybe they activate Ascanta, we get to Bedazzle Ascanta, and they won't be able to counter it. I guess we could do it on upkeep if they don't activate Ascanta. It's probably better here. And if they do use Ascanta... Ooh, Chromium. Alright, that's unexpected. Well, can't kill it with Bedak Bedazzle. So I guess we'll just kill the Yaskanta and then try and block Chromium with our dragons. So 7-7 flying, cannot be countered, and our opponent can turn it into a 1-1 with Hexproof, that's unblockable. But if we just have a few dragons out, we can just try and double block it. So we're down to 13. Not gonna scry enough turn. Do we scry an upkeep? I do want to play Kicked Bladewing here. Do we want to waste some treasures? Probably not. Let's just draw another Bedag Bedazzle. So yeah, let's just play Kicked Bladewing, hope this resolves. Now, going for the double block, this turn could be somewhat risky, because if her opponent has a single spot removal spell, they could prevent us from killing Chromium, although we do have Bedak, and we can always Bedak our own creature to turn it into a 7-powered creature to help us trade off for Chromium. So it could still be relatively safe to double block. Her opponent would need two instant speed answers, basically. Acquisition, opponent searching their library, so not their sideboard. So we don't know what our opponent got, but it took a while to make the decision, so they didn't have like a perfect answer lined up. So yeah, I think I will go for the double block, and then we'll see what happens. Otherwise, we can make the case of playing Sarkhan first, making a dragon, and then being able to triple block and have Bedag Bedazzle up. But with only 2 mana, this feels relatively safe. Alright, that worked. And we get to untap. Upkeep, all scry. And do we want another treasure map? I guess so. This could be a pretty grindy matchup. I'll start by attacking. And then probably play Sarkhan. And then still keep up our treasure cove. Don't want to draw right away in case our opponent has another Thrall Erasure. I would rather keep that extra card hidden for now. So I've got a decent amount of pressure in play now. Cast down the dragon token. Cast down didn't work on Bladewing since it's legendary, but it does work on our dragon token. So maybe that's what our opponent searched up with the acquisition, but then realized that both dragons are legendary. Elder Spell Sarkhan, that's fine. The dragon does not lose. We're just grinding away with our treasure maps here. Right, double Nicol Bolas. I guess we'll start by attacking. And then flip map. Dragon's Horde seems good. Got at least one more dragon incoming. So if we draw the Dragon's Horde, we could play it. I guess that's fine. We do have to sacrifice one treasure, but we get the Horde online. And our opponent scoops it up. Alright, so we managed to outgrind Esper midrange control, not sure what it was exactly. But yeah, Grixis beats Esper and once again destroying the Immortal Sun, so people try to adapt to all the Planeswalker decks by including the legendary artifact in their deck, but luckily in red-black we get access to both Angrass Rampage and Bedevil, which are very versatile cards, helping us deal with artifacts, creatures, and Planeswalkers all at once. Alright, sweet, so that's gonna do it for today's gameplay. Wanna thank you for watching, hope you enjoyed, and as always, have a nice day. I also want to thank all my patrons for being part of the channel, and you can become a patron yourself today and decide the topic of future videos over at patreon.com/legendvd.